Ohio State Buckeyes. Hey there, everybody. Welcome back to the Buckeye Broadcast with yours truly, Emmet Brady. It is Friday afternoon, and I am gearing up for week three of this most impressive Buckeye season, the 2015 Ohio State season. So I wanted to say hi to all the Buckeye Nation around the country, around the world. On this broadcast, as you probably already know, we talk about all things Ohio State and things about the state of Ohio. We are looking at the entire season here through the lens of the run to the championship, the repeat from last season, the number one team in the country. The Buckeyes continue to look really good. Well, you know, to be honest with you, last week was a little bit of a sleeper. Gotta say, it was kind of like the beats per minute never got above 100 for the Buckeyes, but that's okay. They were playing Hawaii, and they easily coasted to a victory, 38-0. They shut out the Rainbow Warriors, and of course, you know, this is how it goes in Big Ten football. The early parts of the season are often played against teams that are just trying to move up in their overall football program. And this week's game, ladies and gentlemen, against the Northern Illinois Huskies, week three, is one of those games. Northern Illinois is one of the top teams in the MAC conference for many, many years. For most of history, the MAC conference was a dirty stepchild to conferences like the Big Ten. But all of that is changing. And on the Buckeye broadcast, we take the deep dive into the nooks and crannies of Ohio State football. But we also take a look at the business of sports. We take a look at fitness and health and nutrition. So we are going to talk today about something very exciting. As you might recall from an earlier broadcast, I am the developer and the practitioner of a fitness system called DAYMA, D-A-Y-M-A. It is an acronym for dance, athletics, yoga, and martial arts. And we are going to talk about a different DAYMA topic every broadcast, put it into context of how to make the Buckeye sports teams and the Buckeye fans the most exceptional athletes in the world. And of course, at the end of the show, as with every broadcast, I'm going to give my predictions. We're going to look into the crystal ball and look not only ahead to this Saturday's game, but we're going to look ahead to November 28th. I got some exciting announcements for the Michigan-Ohio State game. And we might prognosticate on some other fronts as well. So let's look back real quickly. So Ohio State versus Hawaii, you know, they didn't look too sharp. They were playing on a short week. Everybody knew that. And Hawaii, you know, as I put on Facebook during the game, the thing about Hawaii, which makes them a good team to play, is a lot of players from other schools, top-tier schools, that maybe aren't starters, second, third teamers, transfer to Hawaii because they want to get a little aloha loving. And so that team really is a better team than maybe how they looked on Saturday. And the first half, folks, let's face it, the Buckeyes were not the sharpest tool on the field. I have to say that I think, even though the scoring was in the favor of the Buckeyes, I think the Hawaii players, in some instances, they outplayed the Ohio State Buckeyes. They got to Cardale Jones several times, and you know, they had some sacks, and they just really played over their heads. And that's what these out-of-conference teams need to do to make it better over the long run. And you know, the stats and the numbers at the end of the Buckeyes game were not the kind of stats that a number one team should have necessarily. Cardale Jones, you know, he did not play very well. He ran 24 yards on the Buckeyes' first snap, and that was it. And after that, he didn't do too much. He was 6 of 9 for 82 yards in the first half and finished with 100 yards passing. Now, he also fumbled in the backfield, and he recovered those. That's okay, but the good news for me, as far as the season goes and as far as the swishbone offense goes. I coined that term last week. I hope everybody loves that, the swishbone. That's the trifecta of Jones, Barrett, and Mr. Braxton Miller. JT Barrett got some playing time on Saturday. Looked good.
you know, he looked solid for what he did. He 8 of 15 passes, 70 yards, one carry for 7 yards. I think he was involved with a touchdown as well. The one who showed up big, of course, Ezekiel Elliott. We knew in week one against Virginia Tech, Urban Meyer said it was not going to be the Ezekiel Elliott show, but we can expect the Ezekiel Elliott show for the rest of the year. The Mad Zeke, as I like to call him, had a pretty good game. Scored 3 times on runs of 1 and 3 yards, and then a 1-yard touchdown run in the second half. Did get over the 100 mark, the century mark. He had 101 yards rushing, so that was good. On the Hawaii side of the offense, Max Whittick, he's threw for 67 yards, had 2 interceptions. And their only running back of any significance was Paul Harris, a Columbus native, ran for 48 yards. So, as I mentioned, I think on the defenses, for all intents and purposes, it was good to see the Buckeyes at full strength on defense. Joey Bosa had a pretty good game. You know, he made his presence known. Von Bell is certainly making a case as the Big Ten's best deep back. Had an interception, had some big hits. Really just was playing above his head. You know, I was happy with what the Buckeyes did. I think it was good to see them assert their defensive dominance against a team that could put points on the board, but just never had an opportunity, you know. And again, a lot of props to the Hawaii guys because their defense showed up ready to play ball. And you can't expect these smaller division teams, these smaller league teams, to ever be able to go 4 quarters necessarily. However, let me take a moment just now, because we are talking about the state of Ohio and Ohio State. Mad props, big thumbs up to those Toledo, the football team from University of Toledo. They did a number on the SEC, and I'm always pretty happy when anybody does a number on the SEC. It looks like they beat Arkansas on their home turf. How about that? 16-12. And that sends more ripples through the SEC dominance. There's some stupid television commercial right now. You know, it's part of television deals. It's kind of like the deal that NBC has with Notre Dame. You know, it's, I suppose it makes good business sense in somebody's computer books. But one of these television commercials during the broadcast said that the SEC is something like the best conference in the country or something like that. I don't know where they're getting this anymore, but let's face it, folks. The momentum has shifted back to the Big Ten. No doot about it, right? You got 4 or 5 teams this year that could go deep into the bowl series. A couple of them could even qualify for the playoffs, but there's only one that is really destined for the championship. And also the Pac-10. You know, I think that's the other conference that has made a tremendous surge. I do not think in 2015 the SEC is, it might be number 3, but it could be number 4 in the country too. You know, we'll find out how this plays out, but Toledo, way to go. Coming up here, we're going to talk a little bit about DAYMA. We're going to talk about the Northern Illinois Huskies and some predictions. Welcome back to the Buckeye Broadcast with Emmet Brady. Buckeye fans almighty, Emmet Brady here, talking all about all things Ohio State football and all things the state of Ohio. Now, you might know, I'm not a resident of Ohio. I was born and raised
born and raised there, and I'm a California resident, but the scarlet and the gray has gone with me everywhere I've lived. And, you know, the Bay Area, where I spend a lot of time, has got a real big Buckeye fan population. But let's face it, you know, folks from the Buckeye State make pretty good transplants. We go all around the world, and we're not only great citizens, but we assimilate pretty well. We are always fun to watch football with, that's for sure, because that's where, you know, let's face it, as far as great football goes, it's no coincidence that I grew up about 20-minute drive from the Canton Football Hall of Fame and good old CFO Cuyahoga Falls, Ohio. And it's no coincidence that I grew up there, and now I'm doing a Buckeyes broadcast because I think sports as a rule are really deep in my life, deep in my mind and my heart, in my body. And Buckeye football has always been my number one for sure, even more than the sports teams. It's been number one with the Buckeyes. So let's talk a little bit about the game. Now, in week one, if you recall, I'm sure it made every headline on every top 10 around the country, Mr. Braxton Miller, coming back from some pretty devastating injuries to his quarterback shoulder, made some spectacular plays on the field. He made one run downfield where he did a 360 pivot that just left the Virginia Tech Hokies holding their jocks. And I wanted to talk from the perspective of DAYMA of how that happened. See, the focus of, well, there's a lot of focuses that I do when I teach the DAYMA fitness system. And really the idea of DAYMA is just to optimize yourself. Whatever you got, if you're thick, if you're thin, tall, short, if you're fast or slow, whatever your toolkit is as far as your body goes, the system is designed to optimize yourself. Now, here's the shift that's going to happen with this broadcast, and I'm just going to kind of state this quickly, is that, you know, sports on television are a very passive activity for a lot of people. Even going to games is, you know, it's like a spectator sport. But I think that's a little bit outdated. I think that's a 20th century notion. I want to, through the DAYMA system and these broadcasts, maybe encourage some people to come along with a new way to watch sports, where you're going into the games at a very healthy, optimized you, and you can enjoy the sports even more. So in the DAYMA broadcast, the DAYMA section of the broadcast, we're going to talk about the physiology, the neurophysiology, the sociology, the nutrition, everything that goes into being a Buckeyes fan, in a way that each week you learn a little bit more about yourself and a little bit more about how our bodies work. So then when you watch football, it's more of a full experience. It's not just a passive drink your beer and eat your chicken wings. That's a little bit outdated. Let's face it, folks, people got to get healthy. We got a whole state of Ohio that's got some serious health issues, and it's not just Ohio, it's across the United States. It's around the world, of course, but I'm not saying I'm going to answer everybody's health issues with what I'm going to talk about, but hopefully what I'll do for some of you listening to the broadcast is maybe hand you a key to open some doors in your own life, and that's what it's all about. So back to Braxton Miller, running full speed. People are trying to hunt him down and kill him. He's got the ball. He's a premier athlete, and he's in a role that he has never played at the collegiate level. He's a receiver going downfield, top speed, pivots. How does he do that? Well, there's some functional things about the DAYMA system, and one of them is it's all about the cerebellum. So much of our society, so much neuroscience, so much media headlines, so much of your doctor's advice is talking about your cerebrum. How is your memory? Are you able to think clearly? Are you able to get things done? That's all forebrain stuff. The cerebellum is the part of your brain that takes care of the rest of your body. A lot of your involuntary activities, a lot of your muscle movements, running, jumping, sprinting, throwing a football, touchdowns are all about the cerebellum. So when he did that pivot, what's interesting about training in the DAYMA fitness system, now again, DAYMA is an acronym for dance, athletics, yoga, martial arts. 25% of everything I teach people comes from those four different disciplines. So it's a very balanced discipline. And the core of the discipline, the fitness system, is called DAYMA stretch. And it's just a stretch routine that allows you to really get to know your body. And it's a system that you can use over and over again, anytime, anywhere, by anybody, that really optimizes you, okay? Now, when you're watching these athletes, I mean, these young men are the finest athletes in the world, no doubt about it. But you can take the principles of DAYMA and the experience of Ohio State football, and you can put them into your own life.
And the reason his pivot was so important for me is because the thing about training your cerebellum, one of the really important key principles of DAYMA fitness is called bilateral conditioning. And what that means is what you do with the right side of your body, you do with the left side of your body. Now, most people think about this when it comes to like gross anatomy training, lifting weights or sprints or, you know, sidesteps, things like that. And I'm talking about everything you do. You know, if you're used to writing with your left hand, try writing with your right hand. If you're used to dancing just one way, you know, doing the smurf or whatever the hell you do, you do it to the other side as well. If you spin to the right, spin to the left. And why this is important is because the cerebellum, this is a big word, is ipsilateral. Okay, meaning that what you do on the right side of your body is processed by the right side of your cerebellum, and what you do on the left is processed on the left. As opposed to the cerebrum and your optical thing where everything's switched, you know, your right hand and your left side of the brain, the cerebrum, vice versa. The cerebellum, if you train your body to do things equally on both sides, the cerebellum can learn faster. Now, I won't go into too much on this broadcast about the neuroanatomy, but here's how he was able to pull that off. He trained, I'm sure, extensively on the lateral planting of his ankles and his knees, right? So you're moving on an angle away from the core of your body. And he trained on probably spinning in both directions as a quarterback. Do you see how that natural training would lead to the move that he pulled on the field? In the backfield, he's dropping back for a pass, and anytime these monster linemen or linebackers are rushing him, he's got to be able to pivot and spin equally in both directions. Even though he only throws the ball with one hand, Braxton Miller trained himself for how many years now as a quarterback to spin equally each direction. And I'm sure his cerebellum was on fire when he pulled that spin against the Hokies. So there's your little DAYMA lesson. So wherever you're listening to this broadcast right now, sometime this weekend, just spend some time turning left and then turning right and turning left and turning right, and then smile and pat yourself on the back and say, hey, I just trained my cerebellum. Go figure. And this news comes to you only on the Buckeye broadcast with Emmet Brady. Gonna take a quick break, gonna come back and talk about the Huskies in Northern Illinois. Finish off with some predictions. It's beautiful to be a Buckeye fan. Be right back. Of today's Buckeye broadcast. This is week 3 of 2015. We're talking now about the Northern Illinois Huskies, and I'm going to default to Coach Urban Meyer. What does Coach Urban Meyer have to say about this team we're playing tomorrow? Well, he says, this is a Big Ten quality team. Very interesting. Quite a compliment from Coach Meyer, and he knows firsthand. So before we talk about the team that's playing today, let's talk about the team that beat him when he was trying to turn the Bowling Green program around back in the day. He was undefeated. He was marching back in 2002 back towards the national championship. The Falcons of Bowling Green were ranked 20th in the country, and they went into Northern Illinois, and the Huskies punked him. 26-17. Bitter, bitter pill to swallow. This was before he became, you know, the world-class Florida coach for sure. And it was before Utah as well. So this is actually the Buckeyes are Coach Meyer's fourth team. He's born and bred in the state of Ohio, but he's been all around the country to coach. And he really respects this Northern Illinois team. They are led by a pretty, pretty solid offense. The quarterback, the most important person on the team, apparently, is Tommy Lee Lewis. He's one of the most dynamic players in the country. He had last year off, so nobody really heard about him last year. He hurt his knee last year, apparently, but he was a receiving, rushing, returning, and throwing threat. He was All-American consideration. So Tommy Lee Lewis could be one of those players, a little thorn in the Buckeye side this weekend. And their quarterback is pretty top dog as well. His name is Hare, right? Drew Hare. Last year, threw for over 2,300 yards, rushed for 900, 26 touchdowns. He was fifth in the country. I didn't know this. Fifth in the country in passing rating. So, you know, really solid player. The kind of guy who can put points on the board. That's the point. He can score. The offense is good. So this week, I think, is going to be the first week that the Buckeyes defense is really challenged. You know, I feel good about 50% of the deep backs. I really want to see Mr. Apple there in the deep. I want to see him make fewer mistakes, and that's really going to be a matter of leadership. The defensive line, the front seven of the Buckeyes really shouldn't have too many big challenges. But this week, what we're going to find out, and you can mark my word on this one, who is going to step up in the linebacker core of Ohio State? Who's going to make their presence known? The Buckeyes have always been known for their strong middle linebackers. You know, Joey Bosa is getting a lot of the credit and attention this year, and he deserves it, of course. But what really will make the Buckeyes game solid is if their linebackers can hold Northern Illinois' rushing game to nothing, then I think that they don't stand much of a chance to score. I think they will score, but again, it's just like last week. It's a team that, when Coach says they're a Big Ten quality team, that doesn't mean they're an Ohio State quality team. That means they could be a Purdue quality team. And no offense to the Boilermakers, but, you know, they haven't shown up with the ball team in quite a while. And it's tough in the Big Ten because it's always been a lopsided conference. It's not like the SEC where it's top to bottom stacked, or, you know, the Pac-10 seems to go through waves of having really great teams and not so great teams. But, you know, the Big Ten has always been Ohio State, Michigan, Michigan State, Wisconsin. I mean, the rest of them sort of fall into place after that. Penn State, nah, not so much anymore, but oh well. So now let's talk about the Ohio State offense. Again, I'm going to call it the swishbone all year long. Y'all can use the phrase if you want. It's all yours. You can keep it. So the swishbone offense, you can score from any position for Ohio State. The one thing that hasn't shown up yet this year and will be necessary when they play better defenses is the tight end game. And again, we haven't had one particular receiver show up as dominant. Braxton Miller, of course, is going to freak everybody out this year. Because nobody knew that he was going to be such an awesome threat. He's just a superior athlete, you know. So between Barrett and Jones, of course, I think Jones is going to get the call. And then, you know, the other thing, too, which is curious, and this is something that just has to be said this early in the season, is that the Ohio State running game cannot rely exclusively on Ezekiel Elliott, because, you know, things happen throughout a season, and even if they don't happen, sometimes it's good to have a core that's two or three deep. Now, what's interesting here, and this is just for the record, they're calling Braxton Miller, they're calling him a halfback, and that's a position that doesn't get talked about in football very much. It's sort of an old school position, but it could be really important in case this Ezekiel Elliott thing. I mean, he's solid. Again, I talked about cerebellum earlier in the game. Ezekiel Elliott has probably a remarkable cerebellum, because if you notice how he gets hit, he never gets hit hard. And a lot of the great running backs in history, in collegiate and pro history, were like that. Emmett Smith, Barry Sanders, Thurman Thomas. These were some of the great running backs that were Ezekiel Elliott's size, and they just never got hit straight on. That's why their careers extended, you know, 10, 12, 15 years into the NFL, because they came out of college with fresh knees. And that's a really interesting concept. Now, the freshman backup is Mike Weber. He has not been proven. I would think if the Buckeyes go up, there's two of them. There's Briante Dunn, and he's a redshirt junior, and Mike Weber. But I think if the Buckeyes go up by, you know, 20 points in the first half, that they'll get some runs in with the backup running backs. That's my guess. Big weakness, folks, no doubt about it, the special teams. I'm sure that Herb's heard it a lot. They've got to get this kicking thing figured out, both for the punting and for the field goals and for the returns. There seems to be a lack of attention, probably because there's so much attention on the offense, but this is the time where the coach has got to turn to his kickers and say, look, we need you to mentally be in these games. And you know, it can be intimidating for kickers, especially none of them are seniors. There's two vying for the position, and they have to come into the games better focused. They have to get their corpus callosum, the connective tissue between the two halves of their brains, that's where they have to focus. And that involves breathing, visualization, and a control over the cerebellum. Because, you know, the misses that are happening, the mistakes that are going on in the special teams right now are fixable. That's the good news. What we don't know yet is the accuracy and distance that these kickers can really pull off. And that is, I think this is a game. This weekend, they have got to be solid, because they can't afford to do this kind of stuff when they go into the Big Ten Conference. So, and then, of course, the coaching. Last week, I don't think it was Coach Meyer's finest example, but he wasn't sweating it. And I read a great quote from him kind of about where things are going. If you know Coach's story, this is the fun part of Urban Meyer. He comes to Ohio State with a whole new perspective. He's a family guy. He turns to his family for support. He turns to his family for guidance rather than just trying to internalize the whole thing. And his quote was, what he said was that he wanted to enjoy it. He said, quote, I will say this, that I've been in the situation before, and this was about the game last week. I let it be a weight on the team and me. When you're winning a game, it's like, why don't you score this? Why don't you do this? I'm going to see my family and have a hell of a time and make sure that our players come in bright-eyed and ready to rock and roll tomorrow. There you go. Urban Meyer, 2015, leading the Buckeyes to victory. When I come back, a quick little ditty about Ohio State, Michigan, and then my predictions. Nope, just going to blow through. So again, November 27th, I am coming back to Northeast Ohio. Somehow, somewhere, with somebody, I am going to do a live broadcast of the Buckeye broadcast. I've got my sights on a venue in Northeast Ohio. We're going to find out if it works out. But either way, it's going to be a high vibe, high caliber, fun party. It's not going to be a beer brawl. There's not going to be fights. There's not going to be all that sloppy, stupid shit that football fans like to do when they're immature and can't handle their alcohol. It's going to be the funnest, most inspiring Buckeyes victory ever against the Michigan Wolverines. And we are going to be live. To be determined. If you want to touch base with me about that at any point, you can send me an email, eb@thebuckeyebroadcast.com. That's EB, like my initials, Emmet Brady, @thebuckeyebroadcast.com. And now the prediction. Now, so if you've been following here, I'm okay on my predictions so far this year. Last week was kind of a bust, but in fact, in my net points, I'm plus six on the season. So I predicted the Hokies game. I was really close, actually. It was pretty exciting. I was plus one for the Hokies. And then last week, last week against Hawaii, I predicted the score was 52-13, which was a difference of 39 points. And in fact, they won 38-0. So I was plus one on that prediction. And the previous week, I was plus six. So for the season, I'm plus seven. And for this game, I wanted to let you know that Northern Illinois has put up some points. So this is an important one. Now, remember, I'm not a gambler and I don't bet. But this is, I'm not a bookie. But it's worth to note that right now Ohio State's a 34-point favorite. But Illinois is averaging 47.5 points a game. So they can score. So here's my prediction. If the Buckeyes defense shows up, all 11 players, and the special teams is locked and loaded, the Buckeyes are going to run the tables again. Final score, Ohio State 49, Northern Illinois 10. That's my score. 49-10, go Buckeyes. And if you were counting, if you're not counting, you should be. It's 1,392 days since Michigan last beat the Buckeyes, 1,392.
I think it's going to keep counting leading up to November 27th. So at any time, touch base. Thanks for tuning in to the Buckeye Broadcast. EB at the Buckeye Broadcast if you want to follow me online. And just remember, it's a scarlet and gray day every day for the Buckeye Nation. We'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
I guess if you say so, I'll have to pack my things and go.